my name is Chamun Dabeng, and you're welcome to Business Highlights on Trust TV. Join me as we take a walk through economic developments of the week. Now, I have a question for you. Are you still hashtag buying the dip? The moment China announced regulations on cryptocurrency back in September, it sent the already volatile markets on a downward spiral. Cryptocurrency traders and enthusiasts weren't shaken by this turn of events, so they took advantage and hashtag bought the dip. Since the coins are cheaper, they get more coins, thereby making more money the moment digital coins like Bitcoin and Ethereum regain their stance. However, on Thursday, the crypto market practically bled with a sharp fall following corrections in global stock markets. The hawkish stance of the Federal Reserve and expectations of early rate hikes have dampened the sentiment of investors. As the dollar got stronger and positive economic data from the U.S. shook investors' grip on risky financial assets, Bitcoin dropped to $42,500 with a record selling observed in the early hours of Thursday. Bitcoin lost $4,000 in just a matter of hours. This resulted in more than $800 million worth of trading positions being liquidated during the day, with 7,527 traders liquidated. The blockchain world has witnessed investors making the run to safe haven currencies. For those who do not know, safe haven currencies are currencies that are expected to retain or increase in value when it seems like the world is facing geopolitical stress. So currencies like the US dollar, along with the Japanese yen and the Swiss franc, are considered safe haven currencies. So while one group of investors tilt towards safe haven currencies, another group is turning to alternative cryptocurrencies or altcoins like Solana, XRP, and Polkadot, which are down more than 10%. Though the spotlight may presently be on altcoins, buying pressures have declined in both Bitcoin and Ethereum. If BTC does not break back above $45,000, the market may experience an extended bear period in which it could retrace to the low $30,000 range. With a total of 9 countries placing an absolute ban on cryptocurrency, which makes crypto illegal, another 42 have an implicit ban which prohibits financial institutions from dealing with crypto. Coupled with impending tapering and rate hikes, it's impossible not to wonder, what will the future of cryptocurrency be? And should investors jump ship while they still can? I interviewed blockchain expert Usman Isatochukwu on what his perspectives were on the current trend of the market, and here's what he had to say.
The ban. The only thing it will take is just time for government to understand how the operations are being used and then see whether they can have a kind of a mitigation for the ban. Exactly. It's just like when Bitcoin came 2009, nobody thought that it will even rise up to this level. We should not also forget that there was a time that Bitcoin has risen to up to $60,000 and people were cashing out big time. So the question is whether it's going to remain like this or is going to come up. And the answer to it is very clear. It's not going to remain permanent because the market is always ups and down. And let us not forget, there are two different people in crypto business or in crypto market, the traders and then the holders. Those who are holding, when there is a dip like this, it becomes a very good opportunity for them to key into the market and buy more, because there must be that particular time when it's going to rise. The question is when. We don't know how soon, but definitely it's going to come back to life and people will begin to enjoy the moment. But as it is, for the traders, it's unfortunate because that is the business. You gain and then you lose. So if it is time for you to lose, you have to exercise patience for you to gain again when it rises. They should keep exercising patience, because that is what the business of crypto is all about. It teaches you how to be patient, and it also teaches you how to understand the psychology behind the market each time it goes down like this. And the only psychology you can learn when it goes down like this is for you to keep on exercising the patience until the market bounces back again, so that you can profit from what you've lost previously. You're asking me whether I've planned. You should be asking me how much have I bought already. I've killed it too. I've bought already. And I bought as much as $500. And that is just it. Because you see, there are some wrong information that usually Nigerians used to follow when this crypto is going like this. Each time the crypto rises, and people are beginning to trend it that crypto is the real thing now, you will not see people pushing in money. That's not the right time to enter the market. When the crypto is deep, is down, that is the right time for you to enter the market. But majority of Nigerians go and cash out their money out of fear when the crypto is down. That is the real time you are supposed to key into the market, so that by the time it rises, you go and cash out. But the reverse is the case. That is not it. When it's down, it is the time for you to go into the market and buy as much as you can and wait until it comes back alive. And that is just the full stop.
Based on the opinion of CoinDCX's research team, the overall macroeconomic outlook does not appear too optimistic for markets in general. Major asset classes have also been trading at lofty valuations, far detached from fundamentals. The team predicts a continued sell-off on growth, with rotation into value and havens. Coming up next, unhealthy beverages are about to get more expensive. After the break, we talk about the government's latest plan for... You're welcome back to Business Highlights. My name is Chamun Dabeng. As a welcome gift into 2022 from the federal government, Nigerians will be expected to pay tax on consumption of non-alcoholic, carbonated and sweetened beverages. The new policy, which is referred to as sugar tax, is contained in the Finance Act signed into law by President Muhammadu Buhari on the 31st of December 2021. According to the Minister of Finance, Budget and National Planning, Zainab Ahmed, a 10 naira per liter excise duty will be imposed on all non-alcoholic, carbonated and sugary drinks. This move is part of the government's attempt to ramp up low revenues, which authorities say pose major fiscal constraints along with ballooning debt. According to the minister, the tax seeks to discourage excessive consumption of sugar in beverages, which contributes to diseases like diabetes and obesity, while at the same time raising revenues for health-related and other critical expenditure. The sugar tax isn't the only tax that has been introduced. There will also be a 6% tax on digital services to be imposed on non-resident digital companies. For some Nigerians, these new taxes are a welcome development, while for some, the government is being plain old insensitive. I hosted economist Dr. Chijoke Ekechukwu and political analyst Joseph Ago on Business Daily, and I asked them what they thought about the government's new tax imposition, and this is what they had to say.
Our tax figures to GDP ratio has been so low, lower than many other African countries. What they have actually done is to include a good number of things in the tax net of the country. For the first time in this country, we are now seeing that the non-oil revenue projection is looking like 65%, as against what used to be up to 10%, 15% in the past. So the implication of this is that we are no longer going to be afraid of the volatility of the oil price in the market. So in other words, if the oil price today decides to go up or down, we're not going to be so afraid because we have other major sources of our revenue. Of course, you could just recall that before now, previous years, oil revenue was constituting almost 90% of our revenue base, and that was very dangerous for the country. We were so much dependent on that, and in other words, anytime oil price dropped so rapidly, everybody in Nigeria will start coughing. And anytime it increased, the government will start celebrating. So now we're going to be having our own revenue generation in our hands. So the more efficient we are in generating taxes, the more we're able to have to spend. So I think it's a welcome development. That doesn't mean that people are going to be taxed more. In fact, in so many categories of businesses are even going to have some waivers just to make sure that the burden is not so much, especially on MSMEs. So I think it's a welcome development.
All right, Joseph, what do you think?
I think the government's position is quite insensitive.
Okay.
I mean, we're just coming out of a recession. And as much as our tax to GDP ratio is very low compared to other African countries like Ghana, South Africa, but in those countries, we don't hear problems associated with power generation. We don't hear problems associated with government accountability. The problem with taxation in Nigeria is not that Nigerians are unwilling to pay taxes. The question Nigerians are asking is, the taxes that the government collects, how much of it has gone into infrastructural development? How much of it has gone into building business support in the country? So the government's stance is a bit insensitive. I mean, take, for example, the sugar tax. It's quite insensitive. I mean, COVID-19 caused a global logistic problems. I mean, caused a global logistic problem, and that affected even businesses in Nigeria. So the movement of raw materials was an issue. There was also the problem of foreign exchange. You know, Nigeria's naira to the dollar is not really a good situation. So even before the government's moving to levy sugar tax, there has been that pressure in the manufacturing sector, especially let's narrow it down to the companies that produce these carbonated drinks. So just imagine, before COVID, a bottle of La Casera, for example, was sold at 100 naira. Now it's about 150 naira. So what would happen is that these companies will take it in, but what it will translate will be that will translate into will be job losses and increase in prices. We know what happened when the government decided to increase fuel price. Even though it was not so much, the margin was not so much, but we saw transportation increments about 100% in some places and about 50% in other places. So at this point, the government's move to levy taxes on carbonated drinks, and even is moved to levy taxes on digital commodities or products, is a bit insensitive. What the government should be concerned about is how to plug leakages in the system, cut the cost of governance, and also grow that local economy. And interestingly, the government, this present government, government campaigned on all of that, was going to fight corruption, was going to cut the cost of governance, and was also going to diversify, in other words, build economic support in other areas of the local economy aside oil. But it looks like the government is going opposite the direction of what it campaigned in 2015 and 2019.
So far, the Manufacturers Association of Nigeria and economic experts have sounded a note of warning that the new tax imposed on carbonated drinks could possibly be counterproductive. In a recent report published by MAN, it projected that the government might collect approximately 81 billion naira in revenue from excise duty on carbonated drinks between 2022 and 2025, but lose 197 billion naira within the same period from other taxes such as value-added tax and company income tax from the manufacturers of soft drinks. Experts at the Abuja Chamber of Commerce and Industry called the attention of the federal government on the issue of high taxation, stressing that it had crumbled many enterprises and worsened joblessness in the country. The chamber advised the government to broaden the tax base and reduce the country's tax rates. Ultimately, the people of Nigeria want to know that their hard-earned tax naras are going towards building them a better Nigeria. After the break, we move on to the president's exclusive interview with Channels TV, and we're going to be picking an excerpt from the interview. Don't go anywhere.
updates on current topical issues and breaking news by downloading the Trust TV mobile app on your Android devices. Go online, click Google Play Store, search Trust TV, install the app, and get doses of unfiltered information on happenings all over the world in your pocket. Trust TV, documenting the Nigerian story.
You're welcome back, and once again, my name is Chamun Dabeng, and we're moving on to the final leg of the show. On the 5th of January, Nigeria's President Muhammadu Buhari had an exclusive interview with Channels TV. Towards the end of the interview, the president was asked about his thoughts on young people in Nigeria, and let's take a look at what he had to say.
I wish when they go to school, when they work hard, when they earn the degree, they don't do it thinking that government must give them a job. You get educated because an educated person is certainly better than an uneducated one, even in identifying personal problems. So education is not just meant to hang on to government to give you a job. What the colonials indoctrinated on, to have a car, to have a house, and to start work at 8 o'clock and close at 2 o'clock. No.
Now, I can't help but agree with the president's view. Yes, Nigerian youth should be able to make something out of themselves and contribute to the country. Yes, young Nigerians shouldn't have to wait on the government for jobs. They should be able to take what they have learned in their classrooms and identify problems and provide solutions. But have the Nigerian youths of today been provided with an environment in which they can truly thrive? Now, I spoke to business development consultant Kate Palm, and these are her opinions on the issue.
As we know, it is not news, or rather it is common knowledge that the system of education in Nigeria is ranked one of the lowest in the world. In Africa, the ratio of teachers to the student-teacher ratio is quite high. We have the highest per thousand. There aren't enough schools. Not only are there not enough schools, there's no standardized educational system, meaning that there's a huge gap between urban and rural education, public and private education, and so forth. And then as you traverse the country from south going northwards, you will see that when it comes to education, the index or the educational ratios become wider and wider, with as low as 7%. In some parts in the north. So yes, indeed, our educational status is quite abysmal. I mean, it's basic, simple analysis would tell you that if you see an educated person selling akara, like the young man in Kano, you will see the impact of the education there. Because what education does is that, first of all, it enhances your research capability. And even more so that we're in an information age, you can leverage on the information available to add value to what you do. And that would increase, the value of whatever it is that you're doing. So education certainly does play a role. Not only does it help in research capability, it enhances analytical ability. So you're able to look at situations objectively. And that's why you see that where there is a middle class, a level of education, you would see the indicators in the economy, the security, the insecurity is minimized, because people are working and people are engaged. People are able to live, you know, above the bottom of the pyramid. I think that there's been a lot of development, but not strategic or intentional enough to address the needs of the youth. Because when in planning, you want to look at the number of youths, the number of children that you have in 10 years, what will be the number of youths that we have? What are the available jobs that are there or available opportunities? Let's not call them jobs because not everybody is designed for paid employment, right? And so when you look at the activities of past administrations, I would say that not enough has been committed to education in Nigeria. But beyond that, there's a disconnect between the Ministry of Labor and Productivity and the education sector, because there has to be a pull factor. The Ministry of Labor and Productivity should be able to guide the Ministry of Education on the workforce, human capital requirements of the economy. So when they guide them, we know that, okay, we're going to need X number of care workers by so-so-so time, or X number of doctors, X number of engineers because of the projects that are ahead and, just the current situation analysis. But we don't have that. So that absence of strategic planning certainly has been absent. And I think that future administrations need to pay attention to that so that we can build a workforce. For instance, the president in an interview not too long ago said that there are no jobs. Nigerian youth should not expect to get any civil service or any government. There are no jobs. For the leader of the country, first of all, it's not an encouraging statement, to be said. And that should have been followed up with, okay, because of that, policy framework should be developed to say, okay, from the education sector, we need to raise more entrepreneurs. If we raise more entrepreneurs, they will create employment, and then we would increase the employment, decrease the unemployment ratio, But that was not said, and there's no clear indication that that is being planned. So that means that it's important, if there are no jobs, it's important to say, okay, from primary school, what level we need to start educating the young people on entrepreneurship so that they're not even thinking or looking forward to getting jobs, but creating jobs.
The education sector in Nigeria has witnessed a plethora of different challenges, from lack of proper funding, poor infrastructure, unqualified teachers, which are also a product of Nigeria's poor education system, politicization of the sector, and insecurity. And this is just to mention a few. In a 2018 survey carried out by the UNICEF, it showed that the population of out-of-school children in Nigeria had risen from 10.5 million to 13.2 million. The highest not only in sub-Saharan Africa, but also the world. Furthermore, according to the National Commission for Mass Literacy, Adult and Non-Formal Education, NMEC, Nigeria has a staggering 38% non-literate adult population. Lack of a full and proper education has no doubt contributed to Nigeria's high poverty ratio. The high poverty ratio we have witnessed in Nigeria is a cycle, and a lack of access to education or poor education further perpetuates that cycle. Before I round up, let me just say that there is a direct link between education and poverty, indicating how improving education in Nigeria can aid the economic growth of the country and help citizens rise out of poverty. When children are educated, they develop skills and knowledge that can help them secure good jobs in the future or become job providers themselves and make a contribution to Nigeria's economy. Well, we've come to the end of Business Highlights on Trust TV. Make sure that you follow us on all our social media platforms. And don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Well, I'm Chamun Dabeng, signing out.